Good afternoon, Rotary Club of Cincinnati. Today is November 17th, and it is a great day to be a part of Rotary Club 17. My name is Wes Botto, and I serve on the board, and President Steve has asked me to step in and be president for the day. We have a great program in store today. We welcome Evans Mirageas as our speaker. He is now in his 18th season as Artistic Director of the Cincinnati Opera. We're looking forward to your presentation today and to hearing from the two talented performers who are here with us. I have no idea how they asked me to be the MC on a day when we have such great vocalists, but here I am. Luckily, all I'm doing is announcing a few things. We're going to begin our meeting with the national anthem performed by our very own King Steve and his quartet.
Wes, you're looking really good up there on the podium. Thank you for doing that. I think it's great to spread the love around and to show other faces from the board at the podium. I could not resist inviting my singer buddies to come to this event. And I'm really glad that we get to sing first, because I'm really looking forward to hearing Jim perform and Corey, but we're going to do the national anthem for you with my friends Jay, John, and Ken.
Thank you, King Steve Quartet. What a great way to start a great meeting. Please remain standing for the four-way test and invocation by Jane Burkhead.
I am not Kenneth Cleveland. I have two things to say. First of all, thank you everyone for coming. I can't believe what a beautiful turnout we have today. It's really spectacular. The second thing I want to say is Uta helped me with this invocation. So between the two of us, we would both like to say thank you and welcome to Rotary. So please bow your heads and take a minute to be thankful for everything we have at this time of year. We are the best country in the entire world. And now, thank you, Uta. This poem is called Dream Like a Poet, and it's by Tiffany Cupp. Wish on a star, stand up for what you believe in, be proud of who you are. Your legacy is what you leave to the world. Your time is a most precious gift. Experience life in the moment. Time is but a rift. Amen. And now for the four-way test of the things we think, say, and do as Rotarians. Is it the truth? Is it fair to all concerned? Will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be an... No, there's one more. We forgot one. Okay. I always mess it up when I don't write it down.
You may be seated. Thank you, Jane. Next, I welcome Dan Long to introduce our guests and prospective members, followed by Michael Schatzman with an announcement about the upcoming Neighborhood Coffee. Dan?
Hello, Rotarians. We've got a very impressive group of guests here with us, starting out with a company. It's called Steve's Quartet LLC, I believe, are the initials behind it. We have Jay Barry. Jay, raise your hand. And Jay is also, this is a little announcement for Jay. Jay owns Jay Bunyan, which is a firewood and outdoor service company. So if you need something in that area, go see Jay afterwards. We also have Ken Huber that's part of Steve's Quartet. John Zink. And James Eater. We have Patty Horwitz, a guest of Steve King. Patty, welcome back to the Rotary Club. And Patty's good friend, Marcia Bulak, that is also here with her. We have Jeanette Tepe, retired, and she is here with Chad Neeter. We have Brian Bowling from US Bank, a guest of Melinda Kelly. And Victoria Bass Smith, a retired RN, that's here with Wes Botto. Darlene Underwood is a guest of Pete King, and Darlene recently sold her company, so she's retired from the financial management company. Darlene, congratulations on your sale. And finally, a little bit of a paid political announcement from the Membership Development Committee. But here is our member board. And as you can see, our goal, we have 40 members is our goal, and we're at 15. So I had a meeting with my boss, Steve King, just before the meeting, and he gave me a grade of C-. So I'm really not doing real well. So I'm really looking for help from you guys to get my grade up. So please, we need to fill this board up before the end of the year. And one of the things that we really need you to do is if you've brought a member, or if you've brought a prospect to a meeting sometime in the last 6 months, please follow up with that person to see if they're interested in membership or coming back to another meeting. We've brought over 100 prospects to meetings so far in 2022. So we need to convert those prospects to members. Thank you.
Good afternoon. That's it, come on, you know the routine. Good afternoon. Okay, you're getting there. Well, congratulations to President Steve and the quartet on absolutely tearing it up on the national anthem. At the end of it, I was waiting for the jets to fly over. It was that good. But I'm gonna go a little bit off script today. Interim President West, just to let you know. First thing I want to talk about is our next Neighborhood Coffee, which is coming up on the Tuesday after Thanksgiving, the 29th, 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. at Proud Hound Coffee. So what we'll be doing is getting together like we usually do, a little fun, a little food, a little fellowship. And then the owner of Proud Hound, Dan, is offered to give us a tour because they also roast coffees there. So not only will we have fun, food, fellowship, we might actually learn something too. Secondly, going off script, Interim President Wes, Kroger's Reward. You recall we signed up everybody to become a member of the Kroger Community Rewards Program. And I just want to remind everyone, as we head into the holiday season, If you have not signed up for the Kroger Community Rewards Program to benefit our very own Rotary Foundation, please do so. And I'd also like to remind everyone, if you've already signed up to support a church, a school, or another organization, thank you for doing so. Bless you, but don't change it. Keep up with the folks you're supporting. And also, we have a Kroger 4x fuel rewards coupon that Kroger's offering for purchases on Friday. And lastly, a little bit ago, Jane gave us the 4 or 5 way test. And I wanted to, as you know, we do that every week, right? Everybody, yeah, we do that all the time. And we've done it for a long time. In fact, we've always done it. Is that right? Yes, shaking heads. Yeah, we've always done it. Except we haven't done it. That recitation of the 4-way test began under the stewardship of past President Bill Henrich. And Bill is the gentleman that started it during his year as president of the club. And it's nice that we continue that today. And in fact, Bill is with us today. Bill, would you please stand and be recognized? What past President Bill doesn't realize is that today, this very day, is the 30th anniversary of the day past President Bill joined Club 17. So congratulations, Bill. Thank you. And join us for coffee. Bring a prospective member. If you're a new member, please come, and it's a way to get to know everybody. And Wes, I'll turn it back over to Interim President Wes.
Thank you, Michael, and thank you, Dan. Our guests from the Cincinnati Opera have offered to share their talents with us. Given their tight schedule, we're going to move up the program and save announcements until the end of the meeting. I'd like to welcome Deborah Schultz to the podium to introduce today's program.
How fortunate are we to have so many great musical institutions in Cincinnati, including Cincinnati Opera, and to have the kind of leaders who keep them thriving. My mother loved all forms of music, including opera, and encouraged that in her children, as did my public schools. As a young adult, I attended the magical Cincinnati Opera at the zoo and got to hear Aida. You know about the animals on stage and off. My favorite opera experiences were with my husband, Ken Schonberg, at the 28 seasons of Summer Cincinnati Opera. Some well-known productions, some daringly and wonderful new ones, were performed. Ken was a CEO board member in the Society of Angels, born in Buenos Aires, where opera was performed at the magnificent Teatro Colón. He knew so many arias so well that when we attended the opera, he would sing the first few opening notes in a not-so-sottovoce in my ear. It was no doubt annoying to those sitting nearby, but his love of opera was endearing to me. How fortunate am I to have those memories and to introduce today's speaker, Evans Mirageas, in his 17th season as the Harry T. Wilks Artistic Director of the Cincinnati Opera. Evans is considered one of the most talented and respected artistic leaders in the classical music industry today. He brings to Cincinnati Opera a broad range of experience in both opera and symphonic music, as well as a long history of successful partnerships with many of the world's leading singers and conductors. His career in classical music has included radio production with renowned WFMT in Chicago, artistic administrator to Boston Symphony's Seiji Ozawa, and senior vice president of artist and repertoire for the Decca Record Company. He's an award-winning record producer, lecturer, interviewer, presenter, and awards panelist. He recently served as vice president for artistic planning for the Atlanta Symphony, and since 1999 has served as an independent artistic advisor to conductors, instrumentalists, singers, symphony orchestras, opera companies, and other performing arts organizations throughout the U.S. and Europe. Ladies and gentlemen, how fortunate are we? Please welcome to the podium the amazing Evans Mirageas.
With each passing year, that introduction begins to sound more and more like my obituary. Apropos of that, I am delighted to be speaking to you today on this, my 68th birthday. I'm celebrating my birthday with you today. No Cincinnati Opera presentation is complete without music, and I will be playing some recorded music for you as part of my remarks. But let's have the real thing first. I'd like to welcome to the podium my wonderful colleague, James Eater, who will be joined by pianist Corey Batty to give you a sneak preview of the summer 2023 Cincinnati Opera season, which will be officially announced in this room on Saturday night as part of our annual gala. Tickets are still available. James?
Thank you all so much for having me here this morning. It's going to be an absolute pleasure to sing for you. Like Evan said, my name's James Eater. If you are frequent Cincinnati Opera attendees, you would have seen me in La Traviata in 2018 and the Pink Floyd opera, Another Brick in the Wall, where I played a giant bird judge with about a 120-pound costume. I believe a local newsman was also seen wearing said costume on TV at one point in time. But moving forward, today I'm going to be singing La Calunya, Don Basilio's aria from The Barber of Seville. In this opera, Don Basilio is very upset with Figaro. Figaro has done nothing but ruin his plans. So Don Basilio decides that instead of using violence or fighting Figaro in this way, he will use slander to completely ruin Figaro's reputation. So instead of having to fight Figaro, Figaro's opinions will be completely negated. And slander, as we all know, starts with just a little tiny bit, a little tiny lie, and it bubbles and bubbles and bubbles until it is absolutely out of control. This is La Calunya from The Barber of Seville.
Thank you.
Thank you, James. Thank you, Corey. And if you come to Cincinnati Opera this summer, you will be able to see the complete Barber of Seville with an all-star cast in the beautiful surroundings of Cincinnati's eighth wonder of the world, Music Hall. I'm going to talk to you today not necessarily about opera in particular, but mentorship in general, because I thought it would be appropriate today, sitting in front of this wonderful collection of leaders of Cincinnati, all of whom are mentors. You may lend a helping hand to a junior colleague. You may do something worthy in your spare time. You may just give a good piece of advice to the checkout kid at the Kroger. That's all mentoring. And I stand before you today, after that lovely resume that was read, because of several mentors, too many to mention, but I want to pick out a few of them and tell you a bit about them as examples of how I was able to be nurtured and put on a path that I didn't even know existed as a child. Here's my roll call, and maybe only one of those names will sound even vaguely familiar. It begins with Aphrodite Kyriakoulis, my grandmother. Mrs. Correll, my elementary school music teacher. Gabriel Villacerda, my junior high school music teacher. Gert Mauerhoff, the first man to employ me in the world of music. Stephen Skelly, my first boss in radio. Gail Rector, the first genuine impresario I ever met. Artis Krenick, the dynamic leader for over 20 years of one of the greatest opera companies in our country besides Cincinnati Opera, the Lyric Opera of Chicago. Kenneth Haas, a legendary chief executive of one of the great orchestras for which I was privileged to work for many years, the Boston Symphony. Seiji Ozawa, the aforementioned titanically gifted conductor of that orchestra. Ray Minchell, my predecessor at the Decca Record Company, who held that position of director of artists and repertoire for nearly three decades. And last but certainly not least, my most recent mentor, the only recently retired Patricia Beggs, the general director and CEO of Cincinnati Opera. Each of these folks gave me something without ever being asked to give it to me. It was given freely, perhaps without even knowledge that they were giving me something. They were simply living their lives and expressing their love for what they did. And I want to start with my grandmother, because my grandmother was an immigrant from Greece who came over here sometime before the First World War at the age of 13 to be a nanny to two children, 11 and 9. She spoke nearly no English, had the equivalent of a third grade education, but grew up in this country, married, had children, one of whom, of course, was my mother, and lived a wonderful, wonderful, long and rich life. She wasn't a musician, but she was musical. She had an uncanny ear. She could pick out just about any tune on the upright Grinnell piano in her Ann Arbor, Michigan living room. And she had a willing student in me, her then maybe eight-year-old grandson, because she knew that I already loved music. Not classical music, Greek music. Because I would go to weddings and baptisms and watch the clarinet player in the Greek wedding band, like a snake charmer, draw everybody onto the floor. And I said to my grandmother, my Yaya, as we say in Greece, I want to be like him. So she started to teach me how to Greek dance in her living room. And she played this record over and over and over again to get me excited about music. Benny Goodman, eat your heart out. She also gave me the gift of understanding that the sky is the limit by her own life. Someone who came to this country not speaking our language, not knowing what her future would be, and lived a rich and long life partaking of everything this country has to give. I entered elementary school, and in the 1950s and early 1960s, there was still something called public school music. Twice a week, a teacher, mostly women, would come to your classroom with a phonograph. Anybody remember a phonograph? And LP records. And one teacher in particular, my teacher, Mrs. Correll, had the most amazing gift of describing the sounds of music and the stories of music. And the piece of music that she played more often than not that inspired me, not knowing a note of how to read music, but simply being captivated by the sounds, was The Sorcerer's Apprentice. I'm sure many of you have seen the great Fantasia film and remember Mickey Mouse in that hat and that cape. And for me, it was a revelation to hear that music because, of course, what Mrs. Correll was able to do with her fourth grade charges was get them all excited about the sound that music can make and the images that it can generate in your imagination more than anything else. So by the mid-1960s, I was already in junior high school. And lots of kids my age, myself included, were listening to this.
One, two, three, four!
But something else was beginning to captivate me. You may remember my passion for the Greek clarinet player, and that's why I started taking instrumental music. In junior high school, I chose the clarinet, not to become Benny Goodman or a great classical clarinetist, because I wanted to be in the Greek wedding band. I wanted to be the snake charmer. But in order to do that, you had to take lessons and you had to be in the band. And I am the son of a printer. My father ran a small offset printing company in Ann Arbor, Michigan, from the early 1960s until his death in 1975 when I was in college. And I loved order. I loved the smell of ink and paper and the sounds of a print shop, and I loved putting things back where they belonged. And so early mornings before school began, I would volunteer in the office of the music department to file the music that was used in the rehearsals from the day before. And in that office also resided the orchestra teacher. His name was Gabriel Villacerta, is Gabriel Villacerta. Gabe is still very much with us. And in the mornings I would come in, and as I was filing away band music and choral music and orchestra music, he would have, here's that phonograph again, and be playing music on that phonograph. And one morning, he was playing something that was so captivating and so seductive, and something I had never heard before. I asked him, "What is that?" And he said, "Well, that's the Tchaikovsky Violin Concerto played by Yasha Heifetz with the Chicago Symphony Orchestra conducted by Fritz Reiner." I thought he was speaking Martian. I didn't understand anything of what he said. But what he said was, and there's lots more music just like this. For many, many weeks thereafter, every morning I would come in, he would be playing something different. The Brahms Violin Concerto, the Beethoven Violin Concerto, the Bartok Concerto for Orchestra. And sooner or later, I was totally hooked. Listen to this final minute of the Tchaikovsky Violin Concerto, and you might understand why. Goodbye, Greek snake charmer. Hello, classical music fanatic. I instantly asked him, "Where can I get this stuff?" And he said, "Well, there is a record store here in town, one of many in those days, but this one in particular specialized in classical music. He sold everything, but classical music was their thing, and that's where you can buy those records." So in those days, I had an allowance of $3 a week. My dad gave me generously $3. And in those days, you could also buy a budget LP, who remembers budget LPs, for $2.98. I went into the Liberty Music Shop and started buying one record a week. But in those days, you could go into a little booth and listen to the record that you were wanting to buy to see if it was the real thing. And I would go in week after week with my newly minted fanatic knowledge of classical music, next to nothing, but a big ego already, and took four performances of the Beethoven Violin Concerto into the booths to decide which one I really liked. And after about 6 weeks of this, the owner of the store came over to me, a formidable gentleman with a widow's peak and a cigarette hanging out of the corner of his mouth. He scared me to death. His name is Gerrit Mauerhoff. And he said, "Kid, I don't know what to do with you. You come in here every week with your lousy $3, you waste my staff's time, and you walk out of here with one record." I was terrified. I thought he was going to kick me out of the store. I was 13 years old. He said, "Kid, there's only one thing to do. You want a job?" So from age 13 to till I graduated from the University of Michigan in 1976, I worked for Gerrit Mauerhoff. And it was like being given the keys to the kingdom. All of music was available to me, spoken word, popular music, jazz, and of course, all manner of classical music. Gerrit also said after a few months of working there, Evans, you know, recorded music isn't everything. You have to go and hear live performance. I said, Mr. Mauerhoff, I come from a middle-class family. We don't have the money for concert tickets. Ann Arbor happened to be the home of one of the great presenting organizations, still is, that brought all the great musicians of the world to their various auditoriums. He said, oh, no, no, no. My wife and I buy 4 tickets for every single concert, and 2 of them we always give away. From now on, 1 of them is yours. So before I was out of high school, I heard every great orchestra, every great opera singer, including the first recital tour in the United States of a tenor by the name of Luciano Pavarotti, whom I would later work for, actually. And it was an incredible experience because I understood right away the power of live classical music. But I didn't like opera. As a matter of fact, I hated opera. All that screaming and sopranos and dying and death and tuberculosis and knives and jumping off of parapets, silly. But he said, I want you to take home a recording, and if you don't like it, bring it back. If you do like it, you can keep it. And it's not a very famous opera, actually, but it is, for me, the essence of what beautiful operatic and singing can be. It's 2 guys, actually, singing a duet. I would have the stewardship of the second oldest and one of the greatest opera companies in the world, Cincinnati Opera, many years later. That's the duet from The Pearl Fishers by Georges Bizet, the guy who wrote Carmen, his lesser known opera, but one that's filled with beautiful tunes like that. And needless to say, I was hooked. I started going to opera when the Metropolitan Opera was still on tour and came to Detroit every year, and so I got my introduction to live union music, as they used to say, in the wonderful Masonic Auditorium in Detroit. But by the time I got to college, I thought, all right, I'm not going to be the next Benny Goodman. I gave that up long ago. I know a fair amount about classical music now. I'd studied composition. I was what they call a lettered musician. But what was I going to do with all of this enthusiasm? And I decided that it would be radio. In those days, public radio was in its infancy, and every city of any size had a public radio station. Ann Arbor was the home of one of the great early ones, WUOM, University of Michigan. And I soon, into my freshman year, got a job, a part-time weekend job working for that radio station. Stephen Skelly was my first boss. He was the program director, and he saw this wild 18-year-old kid who had lots of energy, enthusiasm, and absolutely no discipline. And he was Dr. No. I'd come up with some harebrained idea, and he would say no. Go refine it. I'd come up with another harebrained idea. He would say, not good enough. Go refine it. I'd send him a script, back though we read from scripts on the radio, and he'd say, your eyes are too close together. And I looked in the mirror and I said, my eyes aren't too close together. And he said, no, look at the page. I this, I that. Your eyes are too close together. He was a wonderful mentor because he saw something in me that he wanted to refine. He saw the energy and enthusiasm and the love I already had for this form, but he said, unless you're disciplined, unless you can focus your speech, unless you can speak in simple declarative sentences, you will never get anybody else excited. And he said, also remember, you are always basically only speaking to one person at a time on the other side of that radio speaker. And sometimes that person is, you are their only companion. And so you better make every word count. But also the University of Michigan's radio station recorded concerts that were being given by the university's musical society. And I got to meet my first great impresario. Now, he wasn't Saul Hurock, but he was something altogether in many ways more magnificent. His name was Gail Rector, and he ran the University of Musical Society that had all these great performers coming to Ann Arbor. And for some reason or other, he said, you know what, this kid, he may have something. We're going to let him record some of our concerts and put them on the radio. So I taught myself how to be a recording engineer and was able to record the Leningrad Philharmonic and the Budapest String Quartet and the U.S. debut of Murray Pariah. And because it was Ann Arbor and not Chicago or New York, musicians were much more relaxed. They were less worried about if there's a wrong note that they play that got broadcast on the air. It was fine. It was only one time only. And I was rubbing shoulders with some of the greatest musicians of our time. None more so than the pianist Vladimir Horowitz. Some of you may remember him, the Russian virtuoso who blazed out of Russia in the early 1920s and until his death in the late 80s, early 90s, was considered the demon of the piano, a reincarnation of Franz Liszt, the possessor of one of the most incredible techniques in history. But he was also a very shy and complicated and conflicted man and didn't like giving interviews. He came to Ann Arbor for the first time since his nervous breakdown in the early 1950s to give a recital in the year of my senior college year, 1975. Mr. Rector held a press conference for Vladimir Horowitz, who hated giving interviews, but he did press conferences. And in that press conference, I asked some questions, and he thought that I asked musical questions, and so, lo and behold, I got the rare interview with Vladimir Horowitz. And from then until his death a few years later, I would correspond with him and Mrs. Horowitz and went to hear him in concerts. And in 1979, he let me record his concert, something he had never done before in his entire career for a local radio broadcast. He had a specialty. He loved to end his concerts with something totally flashy. And he had his own version of bits and pieces from Carmen. This is the finale from that performance I recorded in 1979. Very happy people in Ann Arbor's Hill Auditorium in 1979. Soon thereafter, I was hired away to go work at a larger radio station in Chicago, a legendary radio station called WFMT. It had a wonderful, ambitious program whereby if you loved all things classical and had all the time and money you needed, what would you do every week? Where would you go? Who would you see? And I was given the job of creating an hour-long documentary every week for 7 years, doing just that. Eventually going to Europe as well and recording interviews with every luminary in the world of classical music, rushing home to Chicago, putting a program together, putting it up on, anybody remember the satellite? And wash, rinse, repeat. Do the same thing the next week, all over again. And because I wasn't a journalist, I was a musician giving each organization an hour of free national publicity, I had unparalleled access to the musicians who made the music. I learned so much by watching the creative process in nearly every great concert hall and opera house in the world. But back home in Chicago, we had, of course, the great Chicago Symphony Orchestra and the great Chicago Lyric Opera. Well, my boss at that time, a man by the name of Norman Pellegrini, felt that the Chicago Symphony Orchestra was his personal property, and I was to get nowheres near it. But the Chicago Lyric Opera, he didn't much like opera. Oh, he liked it. He was Italian-American, but he was more concerned with the orchestra. So he said, go ahead, kid. You can also produce the Lyric Opera broadcasts. So for 8 years, I lived at 20 North Wacker Drive, the home of Lyric Opera of Chicago, and watched like a hawk its amazing impresario and director, a legend in the opera world, a woman by the name of Artis Krenik. Artis had coming to her opera house nearly every year both Pavarotti and Domingo, every famous soprano, mezzo, great conductors, and of course, sold-out houses. They were 102% subscribed in the 1980s. Would that we had that today. But Artis was my model for how to treat singers. She handled them with such dexterity because she had been a singer herself, and she knew the mentality of what drove singers. They're basically, sorry, James, all children, meaning that they can be childish, but if you treat them well, you tap into that reserve that all great artists keep into great old age if they're lucky. They never lose the childlike wonder and passion for doing what they love to do. If it's a kid playing with Tonka trucks, or if it's a soprano singing Lucia di Lammermoor, it's the same thing. With great neuroses attached, of course, by the time they get to be world famous, but that's what we're paid to deal with. I watched artists over and over again take a difficult Pavarotti or an uncooperative Shirley Verrett and turn them into pussycats because she knew how to talk to them. And she knew what to give them. And it wasn't always money. It was attention. It was a shoulder. It was an ear. I learned so much from her, and she never had a meeting with me. I never, went to dinner with her, but I watched her every single day for 8 years. I'll tell you one brief anecdote before I move on to my final mentors, which is one day I was given the wonderful task of interviewing the wonderful soprano from Italy, Mirella Freni. Mirella Freni was singing her first role in Russian. She mostly sang Italian and French repertoire, but she sang this heroine in Eugene Onegin. And she was married to the great Bulgarian basso named Nikolai Giaurov. Now, you remember that in the old Soviet times, no matter what Soviet country you were in, you had to speak Russian as well as your own language. And so foolishly, with the young Tyro interviewer's innocence, I asked Ms. Freni in my recorded interview, Signora Freni, you are singing in Russian for the first time. It sounds beautiful. Where did you learn to sing Russian so well? And she smiled and looked at me and she said, in bed. I kept it in the interview. I moved on to work for the Boston Symphony for several years, for the Boston Symphony's great music director, Seiji Ozawa, and I was able to watch at close range and work closely with some of the greatest instrumentalists and singers and conductors of our time. It was such a school of watching Seiji, who was at the time at the absolute height of his powers, manage not only the Boston Symphony Orchestra, but make magic every single time he stepped onto that podium. We went all over the world, toured to Japan, to South America, to Europe, across the United States. And watching a great symphony orchestra at work gave me such respect for the talent and the time and the treasure it takes to play at the top of your game. It's helped me immeasurably in the years since I've been here in Cincinnati and working with our great Cincinnati Symphony Orchestra, because of course, to have that orchestra in the pit is an incredible luxury. I moved on to work for several years for the Decca Record Company in Europe, the record company of Luciano Pavarotti. I produced Luciano's last 7 recordings. And it was, again, a revelation for me because I succeeded someone who had the job for 30 years. His name was Ray Minchell. And Ray taught me a great deal, but particularly he taught me to stick to your guns when you think you've got the right idea. Because your colleagues, remember, this is a commercial enterprise, not a not-for-profit institution. Your colleagues may think that the bottom line is the only thing that matters, and if you don't sign someone who will deliver for you immediately, you're not going to be a success. But he said, don't listen to them, because we hired you for your instincts and your knowledge. And I remember the first time I heard soprano Renee Fleming. She was a substitute, actually, in a performance at the Boston Symphony. And I kept my ear open. I said, this young lady is going places. And when I came to work for the Decca Record Company, sure enough, there was another cancellation for a very prestigious recording with Sir George Schulte. And he said to me in his incredible mélange of accents, he was Hungarian, learned to speak German as a young man, eventually learned to speak some form of English, and was the music director of the Chicago Symphony for many years. And he said, my dear, my soprano has canceled. Who is this Renee Fleming? I said, Sir George, she's a wonderful singer. Take a risk on her. He did. She came. She conquered. I signed her to the Decca Record Company amidst tremendous opposition from my English colleagues because they said, an American, she'll never sell in Europe. Well, we signed a couple of other prominent European singers in my time. They've vanished. Renee Fleming is still making millions of dollars for the Decca Record Company every year. And that's not to say that I'm clairvoyant or that I have some special powers of divination when it comes to singers, but Ray taught me, stick to your guns. Make sure that if your gut tells you it's right, follow your gut. So I'd like to close by repeating your four ways with a fifth. Is it the truth? Is it fair to all concerned? Will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be beneficial to all concerned? I want to stick on that for my fifth test, to say you must mentor. All of you know an 11-year-old Evans Mirageas. He or she may have some little spark that you see. Give freely. Give without any idea of return on your investment, because you may be sending someone on the next point in their journey to a wonderful career, to the realization of dreams they never even knew they had, and great success. Pay it forward, it will pay you back. Thank you.
Evans Mirageas, thank you so much for the presentation, and what a humble way to present your story, talking about your mentors, and may we all follow in exactly what you said and do that for our community. Clearly, you and the Cincinnati Opera are champions of art and imagination. Our Rotary theme this year is Imagine Rotary. We share your belief that the future demands creativity to meet the challenges and issues that we're facing. As a token of our appreciation for your presentation, I'd like to present you with a Rotary Club of Cincinnati coin. Inscribed on this is the four-way test that you referenced. Maybe you can find a way to inscribe another, your fifth. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Pleasure. I'll treasure this. Thank you.
In addition, in recognition of your presentation here today, we are making a gift to the End Polio Now campaign in its four-decade effort to eliminate wild polio from the planet. We are this close, with only a handful of cases left in the world, but need energy for the final push. Let's give Evans Mirageas another hearty round of applause. Thank you. Turning now to several important club announcements. Next week, there is no meeting. If you didn't know, Thanksgiving is, in fact, next week. This week's meeting is sponsored by Bonnie Reddick. Thank you, Bonnie, for your art, your love of the arts, and for your sponsorship. Birthdays this week. I think we have some of these people here today. Mark Romito, Angie Hawk, Brian.
Yes.
Happy birthday, everyone. Ariel Miller, I saw you as well. Happy birthday. Not sure if Dawn is here. Next, Split the Pot, the moment you've been waiting for. Thank you for your patience. Today, 25% the pot goes to the winner. That is $50 today. The rolling pot, the accumulating pot, is now up to $883. And 50% goes to the club for our membership development efforts. Evans?
Pressure's on.
Okay, the number is 538-3922. The last four are 3922. Anyone? Anyone?
It's like power.
Somebody leave? Okay. 538-83-922. 3922. Nope, okay. Going once, going twice, we're going to let Evans
do it again. This really is like power.
Thank you. All right, let's try this again. 5, 3, 8, 3, 7, 7, 9. Okay. Yeah. Okay, starting to think a little funny business going on here. 3779, last four. Here we go. Yes. Let's see if we can give away the accumulating pot this week. Remember, we are drawing for the Queen of Hearts, and guests are not eligible. Oh, so close. All right. Club dues are coming soon. So me and my role as treasurer, I get the fun of talking about club dues. Invoices for club dues will be sent out over the next few days. The great news is that lunch costs, despite record high inflation for food, for the first half of next year will remain the same. Both prepaid and at-the-door pricing will remain the same through June of next year. I do want to mention one thing really quick. Many of you noticed in the news this week that the owner of the Hilton is facing foreclosure. The situation is fluid and we don't have any additional details to share beyond what you read. For the club, it is business as usual, and we're operating under the assumption that the Hilton will continue normal business during this ownership transition. Just know that the Rotary office and club board remain laser focused, ensuring continuity of the club through whatever the future holds. The board and President Steve will offer updates to the club as we learn more. As far as dues, getting back to that, so like I said, lunch costs are not increasing. More good news, there's a new Young Professionals Flex plan. We're implementing a flexible pricing model similar to the Active Flex model we began offering last May. Please contact the office if you're interested in switching to the YP Flex. As a reminder, YP is 39 and under. Okay. The not so good news, but it could be a lot worse news. Club dues are increasing modestly across all membership categories. This is necessary to supplement revenue in the first half of next year based on year-to-date variances to current year club budget. Moving on. Rotary After Hours, it was scheduled for tomorrow. It's canceled. Bob Brandstetter is under the weather, so the event is not happening. We will update you once this gets rescheduled. But the good news is that on that same day, we have the UC Rotaract Thanksgiving. UC Rotaract is hosting a dinner for all international students who cannot travel home or are unable to visit family for this holiday. Alexia Autry reports that they have over 65 students signed up. The event will be held on November 18th, 5 p.m. to 7. Check the link in the e-raise to RSVP. Upcoming hands-on service projects on the Saturday the 19th at Roberts Academy will engage in second workday at Roberts Academy in Price Hill. This will be from 9 a.m. to noon. Roberts Academy is the largest school in Cincinnati Public Schools and is located on the west side of Cincinnati. We will be adding water catchment to the shed on the property, building vegetable beds, and starting a pollinator garden. Tools needed are gloves, drills, rakes, and wheelbarrows. Many volunteers are needed. Please RSVP in DACDB or contact Jody DeVoid for more information. The Fall Feast Thanksgiving Vision screening is back. For those of you that haven't participated in this, we did this. I actually brought my family to this a few years back, and it was a great time. Great way to give back on Thanksgiving. This is on Thanksgiving Day from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the Duke Energy Center downtown. Four Rotarians are needed throughout that time. As you know, this project was originally organized by longtime Cincinnati Rotarian Dr. Ira Abramson. It's a volunteer, RSVP in DACDB or with Hux Miller. The Roselawn Condon School Christmas Party. We still have seven tags left. Folks, we need to get, so here's Christy with the seven tags. Just raise your hand, she'll give it to you. We need to find homes for these seven tags. We can't let these kids go without Christmas gifts. So please take one after today's meeting. Only two left, is that right? Okay, that's great. All right. Please remember the children's gifts should be wrapped with the wish tag taped to it and returned to Christy by the Wednesday before Thanksgiving. If you would like to drop it off at the office, call the office, and Christy has offered very graciously to come down and meet you at the curb. Professional Development Series is Thursday, December 8th. We have a great program ahead. It is December 8th. Will be held at 10:30 a.m. before the Thursday meeting, again on the 8th. Attendees will join Carol Butler, the president of the Gehring Center. And as you know, that this is the Gehring Center for Family and Private Business is North America's largest university-based educational center, serving more than 400 closely held businesses. Ms. Butler will teach us about working on the business versus in the business, boards of advisors, and boards of directors. Be sure to RSVP and DACDB for this very informative session. Now I want to move on to sad news from the family of Rotary. We were sad to learn of the passing of Mark Horowitz on October 31st. His wife, Patty, is here with us today, along with a family friend, Marcia Bulock. Mark joined our club in July 2005 and served on the board of directors from 2014 to 2018. Mark was a great friend and he'll be missed dearly. I know that I will miss seeing his bright smile, whether it's walking through Crossroads or here at Rotary. A celebration of life will be held on Saturday, November 26th at 11:30 a.m. at Crossroads. Mark was very active with the club and lived a life full of service to others. Patty shared that in death, Mark donated his body to UC in hopes they could learn to save others. In addition, Patty shared that Mark left a very generous gift to the club and his estate plan. Patty, thank you for coming today. Our hearts ache for you and the family. Please know that your family is in our thoughts and prayers. Just a few final comments. We have several committee meetings this week. Rotary Due Days Committee, Julep Room, third floor. Women, nope, that one's canceled. World Affairs Committee, Salon M. Environmental Sustainability Committee, Salon A, fourth floor. That one's canceled as well. There we go. Membership Development Committee in the Hall of Mirrors. Again, no meeting next week. Happy Thanksgiving. See you in December. Meeting is adjourned.